Good afternoon, ladies and gentlemen. The growth of internet has been one of the biggest social and technological changes. The increasing dependency upon information technology, systems, and networked operations pervades almost every aspect of a modern society. And as it is with most things, the good comes with the bad. Cybersecurity and cybercrime are some of the key challenges or the new modern life challenges that we face as an individual, as corporates, and as nations. We are very pleased to have two very distinguished panelists with us here. Seated to the right of me, Sir John Sors. Sir John is the former chief of the British Secret Intelligence Service, SIS, more popularly known as MI6, even more popularly known as James Bond and Madam M. I had to put that in. A role he held for 5 years from 2009 to 2014. During his tenure, he modernized the service and led it through major changes in operations, technology, and public accountability. Sir John had a long and distinguished career with the government for 36 years. He was previously the UK's permanent representative to the UN in New York, political director of the UK's Foreign Office, special representative in Iraq, Her Majesty's ambassador to Cairo, and foreign policy advisor to the Prime Minister from 1999 to 2001. After retiring, which was only a few 18 to 24 months ago, 18 months ago, as Chief of the Secret Intelligence Service, Sir John became partner and chairman of Macro Advisory Partners, who provide strategic advice and insights to investors and governments. Please join me in welcoming Sir John. Thanks. To the right of him is Ben Wootliff. Ben is Managing Director of Control Risks Cybersecurity Practice in Asia. In addition to managing cybersecurity projects for clients and developing methodologies and product offerings, Ben leads the cybersecurity strategy for control risks in Asia. He's also the General Manager of Control Risks Hong Kong, where he has oversight of a range of investigative, crisis, and security management and political risk projects. Prior to this, he managed the corporate investigations team in Europe and Asia, including managing the corporate investigations business in Greater China and North Asia. Several projects he has been involved with, I will highlight a few of those, including the cyber due diligence that he has done, focusing on information security integrity of an acquisition target for a major US private equity firm, advising a global resources company on their response to wide-ranging cyber breaches and security failings, analyzing threat actors, and advising on subsequent remediation. Prior to moving to China, Mr. Wootliff managed a control risk corporate investigation financial service practice, which was responsible for the company's relations with banks, investment banks, private equity firms, and asset managers. Please welcome Ben to this panel. As would have gathered, we have a broad range of issues to discuss, and we have two experts, one on a more macro, more policy level, one who knows the nitty-gritties of what needs to be done. So we will try to cover. We only have now 46 minutes, 45 minutes, 59 seconds to go through that. What I will do is to start the panel with asking a couple of questions here front, and both Ben and Sir John can address those, and we will open it up for Q&A, and you please, we want to make it as participative, and as do the panelists, want it to be as participative as possible. Maybe a good place to start here would be, again, question to both of you. What do you think are the major cybersecurity risks that we as individuals, as nations, as corporates face? And more importantly, in your practice, where do you think is the level of understanding of these risks with people involved or for countries involved? And what is the level of preparedness?
Well, perhaps I can kick off, Manish. Sure. First of all, thank you for inviting me to be part of this panel. The whole question of cybersecurity is at one level relatively new, and it's changing incredibly rapidly. And as you can't say that there's one threat that everyone should look out for above anything else, because the threat any company, any corporation, any organization faces is going to be specific to what they do. But I think any organization needs to be aware of probably four different sources of threat. First one, and it will vary according to what sort of organization you are, which ones are most important to you. The first one, and most obviously, are nation states. Countries which want to either acquire your intellectual property, your data, or to have the capacity to bring you down and disable you. Now, we could talk about a range of countries in this category, but I think it's pretty clear that countries which are going through rapid development, like China, are benefiting a lot from the intellectual property that can be gained through cyber attack. I think countries like Russia are thinking about cybersecurity and cyber attacks more in terms of the military capability that it gives them. And countries like Iran are thinking more in terms of disruptive powers that cyber can give them. And we can talk about examples later on. So nation states is definitely one area. The second area is cyber criminals. People who want to defraud you or hold you to ransom or hold you at risk in order to extort money out of you. And cybercrime is a very rapidly growing area of business and one which the financial sector is clearly particularly vulnerable to. So criminals would be the second area. The third area is what you might call hacktivists, political activists who want to hack into your systems in order to embarrass you. We've had a wonderful example of that over the last 2 days with the leak of all this information from Mossack Fonseca in Panama, which I don't know much about the technical details of it. Maybe Ben has some more on it. But that strikes me as a classic hacktivist action where for political purposes, which you know, ordinary citizens might have some sympathy with, a corporation doing a business which may be at the limits of what is legitimate, nonetheless is exposed to political hacking, which has caused them massive reputational damage and will undermine their business model. So the third is political hacktivists. And the fourth, probably least understood or appreciated, is the insider threat. In our estimation, about 80% of successful cyber attacks are facilitated one way or another by insiders. Now, most of those insiders are unwitting, and the biggest people at fault unwittingly helping cyber attacks tends to be the most senior people in the organization, who are much more likely to click on a suspicious email and invite malware into your system than your average worker on the trading floor. But there are also malign insider threats that you have to face, particularly when you're going through a period of upheavals, of mergers or layoffs or major transitions, when individuals within the organization may feel particularly aggrieved and want to get back some way, either for financial gain or for just to cause some damage on their departure from the company. So I think those are the four main sources of threat. I think they're understood to different levels, and different organizations have widely different appreciation of the threats that they face. I don't know a major, say, FTSE 100 or Fortune 500 company that doesn't have cyber as one of its board-level risks. But whether that's connected to the actual people responsible in the organization for cyber is another question. And equally, I see companies who, by luck or judgment, recruited someone who's really good on cybersecurity, and they've done a really good job in the company, and the fact that the board is faffing around doesn't actually matter, that there's nonetheless the company is quite well served. But I think overall, the level of understanding is not high, and the level of preparedness for a major attack is actually quite low in most companies. But we can talk about how to deal with that. But sorry, Ben, I've probably gone for too long.
Good point to maybe start, Ben, for take from there.
Yeah, no, I mean, the taxonomy of the cyber threats is exactly what I would agree with there.
Yeah.
The state actors, the criminal actors, the activists, underlying through that, the insider threat. Mm. I mean, just as a few sort of asides to that, traditionally people have imagined the state actor threat to be concentrated among permanent members of the UN Security Council, joking aside. I think what you would sort of put as the threat actors, we've identified 45 countries with a cyber capability, and that may be a cyber attack capability or a cyber espionage capability. And that's the 45 companies we've identified who've in some form or another publicly declared it. So there's probably another, you know, similar amount who have this capability. And if you're a state actor, it's actually very easy to buy cyber capability off the shelf. So that's the thing. In state actors, it's a very broad threat. And as Sir John has just said, this is typically motivated by an extension of national policy aims. Different countries have different policy aims. So I think a lot of the UK and the US, their cyber efforts have been focused on dealing with terrorism around that. That's been a foreign policy threat that we face. So that's how we look at the state actors. In terms of criminality, criminals are motivated by money. That is the simple rule there. What's interesting about criminality is we've seen an explosion of it in the past 10 years. Both the means to commit cybercrime and the liquidity of assets which can be acquired through cybercrime has escalated rapidly. I think 10, 15 years ago, if you wanted to be a cyber criminal, you had to be a technical expert. Now that is not necessarily the case. You can go out and buy the capability to do this. You can buy the capability, you can buy the software, you can buy the services, and these can be bought with, you go onto the dark web, you buy these services. They come with a rating, like on eBay or Amazon. They come with a money-back guarantee. You're not satisfied, we will give you your money back in 24 hours. They come with a help desk. I am not joking. This is really how it is. It's a very sophisticated marketplace. And likewise, the liquidity of these assets. If I stole credit card details 10 years ago, if I did a breach like Target faced, I would then have to go out and essentially create those credit card details myself, or use those to create new cards and use that, process that information to monetize that information myself. Now, I don't have to. I can go out and sell those credit card details on the internet. So I can go, and there are marketplaces which buy and where you buy these internet, and you say, I want credit card details for Hong Kong, for this bank account, have this level of quality, were stolen, you know, a week ago, so nobody knows about it, and you can get that. So again, it's a very liquid marketplace, and I think that has led to one of the reasons we've seen the explosion in criminality. And finally, on the activists, interestingly, activists tended to be almost retrospective in their actions. What do I mean by that? Activists, up until fairly recently, were the 16-year-old kids. They were the anonymous group, and they're kind of doing it to show they can do it. It's exciting, it's fun, you know, graffiti. There was always often a retrospective aim to what they were doing. It was, I have got into here, found out what I've defaced this website, and then I've defaced this website, and they found a reason to do it. I don't like capitalist society, or, you know, their burgers don't taste good, or something like that. But it's going backwards. It's looking backwards. They find the low-hanging fruit, and then find a reason to go after that. Now what's happening is activists are becoming actually increasingly targeted. I think actually we're seeing, both across activists and criminals, an increasing sophistication of the targeting. They're identifying assets which are valuable and either selling those assets or compromising those assets in a certain way. The final point to that is that we are seeing an increasing level of breakdown between the silos of activist, criminal, and state groups. So we're now seeing state groups, and be interested to see what Sir John has to say about this, but state groups using activists as proxies. State groups going out and buying services off criminal organizations. Activists financing their activist activities through criminal work. So there's a sort of fungibility there, which is creating problems, again, in how to respond to them, because different organizations use different tactics, techniques, and procedures. A state actor has different capabilities and going after different things to an activist group. But once you get the diffusion, it makes life a bit more tricky.
And very interesting, just to build on that, the North Korean attack on Sony a year ago is a very good, very interesting example of a much more sophisticated attack than would have normally been associated with North Korea's capability. Mm-hmm. And an ability to not just steal the information and disrupt it, which is relatively straightforward, mm-hmm. but then to produce a target emails which would embarrass the organization and humiliate it and do damage to its reputation, not just to cause it sort of financial mm-hmm. business losses. Now, quite how the North Koreans went about that, what its role with organized crime was in order to do that, not clear, but it was an example of a state actor intervening to cause reputational damage and for political effect, rather than to build up sort of state secrets or to strengthen the power of the state that was sponsoring it.
Coming back to preparedness, I mean, it's interesting you pick on the example of Sony. I think Sony is an example of a very large organization which probably wasn't very well prepared. Mm-hmm. I would actually be harder than you were on most organizations. I think most organizations are pretty ill-prepared in terms of the way they see the cyber threat among sort of Fortune 500, FTSE 100.
Yeah.
I think, as you say, there's an awareness in the board that this is a problem, but the most board levels are still seeing this as a technical problem. Mm. They see it as computers attacking computers. They don't see it as criminals, state actors, activists going after corporate assets. So, and the problem with putting technical people in charge of it is most of them will see it as they will see the technical solution as a panacea.
Yeah.
Now, any organization could be compromised. The NSA could be compromised.
Yeah.
It's not a matter of when you're going to be, or if you're going to be breached, a matter of when. So it's important to be able to combine both the non-technical aspect of responding to the cyber threat, both as preparedness and in response, with the sort of technical aspect. And I think most organizations are failing on a governance perspective in doing that.
Well, certainly when I was chief of MI6, we obviously faced a fairly substantial cyber threat, and we had to defend our systems. And we went through various phases of trying to get this right. Mm-hmm. We only got it right when we had the technology people, the security people, and the business people in the room at the same time from day one.
Absolutely.
Designing the system so it met the requirements of all three branches of it. If you left out any one of them, then, as one of my colleagues said, unnatural acts occur. Because if you miss out one of those three elements of technology, security, and the business, then you find other people feeling that their needs aren't being met, and they find workarounds to avoid the systems that are in place. You've got to have buy-in across the organization in order to get the cybersecurity right.
That was very good framing of the problems involved, but that creates the next problem, which the way you guys have described it, it looks like how do as individuals and corporates, can they even manage the risk given the involvement of multiple parties that you said, including the national? Mm. Or is this a security issue? Is it a national security issue that needs to be handled at a much higher level where individual participants participate in it but can't really protect themselves?
You've got to respond at every level.
Yes.
You've got to have a national response to this. You've got two Brits on the platform by coincidence, but we have a system in the UK where the government is setting various standards led by the British equivalent of NSA, the GCHQ, and there's now a system in place called Cyber Essentials, which anybody who wants to win a contract from government and increasingly from major corporations, you have to have qualified and got the sort of cyber essentials qualification in order to meet the basic hygiene standards. But you've also got to work it through the company that you're running, so that at every level, from the board down to the shop floor or the trading floor, everybody is educated about the cyber risk, knows about the dangers. You patch your system. It's about computer hygiene. It's about a whole series of systems that you need to have in place at every level of the company to keep yourself in the best possible shape. Decent computer hygiene will deal with over 80% of the threats that you're facing. It doesn't mean you can deal with everything, but having a proper understanding of the scale of the risk and having an integrated response within the company and indeed within the country is an important part of it.
Yeah, I'd like to sort of take a step back on that. I think part of the problem with cyber is that it's most of the people sitting at board level are sort of late 40s, 50s, 60s. Yeah. They're not technically adept, most of them, outside the tech sector. Specifically, they're not comfortable with it. They have... and they see this as a, coming back to the, they see it as a technical issue, computers attacking computers. They don't see it, most of them, as looking at, well, who wants to get me? Who is out to attack me? Am I more of greater interest to criminal groups? Do I have an activist threat? Do I have a state threat? And then they also don't actually understand what they're trying to protect. It's very rare for an organization to sit down and actually understand, okay, what are my key, my core information assets that need to be protected here? Mm. And if you think about it, if you sit down and say, well, what am I trying to protect? I am trying to protect, as a retail organization, for instance, my customer data, my loyalty card scheme against criminals who want to steal it. And I'm going to put a big protection around that, and I'm also going to protect my point of sale here, and I'm protect that, and I'm going to make sure that my online sales platform is protected. The rest, I'm going to put some level of protection around it, but the key, the crown jewels, are really going to be locked away in the safe. And you put your resources and your asset and your investment around that, and that's a way of sort of conceptualizing it in terms of return on investment. Because the other problem is, you get corporates saying, well, how much do I have to spend to protect myself? Mm. And it's like, well, the CTO sits down and goes, well, you know, Mr. Chairman, Mr. CEO, this is going to be a dreadfully expensive exercise, and we're going to have to put a huge amount of new technology in. And the CEO just goes, well, I can't be bothered. What's the likelihood? You know, none of my competitors have been breached, so let's ignore it. So there's, I think, a weakness to a failure to understand it from a strategic perspective. But if they look at it from that perspective, then it's much easier to understand. It becomes much more of a manageable threat from a sort of board level perspective.
That leads to the other question, which is always there in personal life as well. But now, with so much of people's life, particularly people under 30, being online, the issue of security versus privacy, the debate between Apple and FBI, the whole NSA debate and Snowden debate is, where do you draw the line of privacy versus security? What is good versus what is private?
Well, it won't surprise anybody that someone from a security background like me has some sympathy with the FBI's concerns that a known terrorist, because he's blown himself up, should not enjoy sort of protections of privacy in his afterlife. There's no doubt that the purpose of providing for security in society is to underpin the basic freedoms of that society, especially in Western democracies. So there's no interest at all in the security agencies doing things that undermine the basic freedoms of that society. And I do understand, especially in the wake of the sort of the Snowden argument, post-Snowden arguments, why people are worried that the level of data collection could give rise to a surveillance society. Now, clearly, the Stasi or the KGB or organizations like that would love to have had the capacity to soak up so much information about the entire citizenship of a country, which is where democratic protections of requiring legal warrants, political oversight, a presumption of privacy and intrusion only when it's justified and clearly set out what those intrusions require. So I think there should be a presumption of privacy in society, but I firmly believe that there has to be some capacity, in the same way there was ultimately to tap a telephone wire. Ever since the telephone's been invented, the police and the security agencies have been able to tap a telephone wire, that you need to be able to access information that is being exchanged on any technological means if that is going to otherwise threaten the stability of your society. If you look at it the other way around, if you create space which is 100% guaranteed, inviolable private space, then you give the possibility for every organized criminal, pedophile, terrorist to do their worst, to organize on a platform where they know there is 100% certainty that no one can understand them. You only need 1% possibility that you can penetrate that to change the people's behavior. And we have to somehow derive a system which will require a degree of cooperation between technology companies and governments and intelligence agencies, which needs to be sort of have legitimacy in a democratic society, of course, but it needs to be some way to inject uncertainty into the behaviors of the enemies of society so they cannot operate with both impunity and total privacy to do everything they can to undermine that society. So that requires some capacity to intrude. And I think the best way, frankly, is not for the courts to decide this. It's not even really for legislators to say, this is the line, on this side you can do it, on this side you can't. But for actually under the oversight of elected politicians, for the technology companies and the security agencies to actually get together and try and find a way where a legitimate balance is created and a degree of uncertainty is also created for those who want to undermine society.
Ben, anything to
add? I mean, I think most people agree that the right to privacy is not absolute. I don't think anybody says, or there's very few people, I mean, especially in Western Europe as opposed to the US, which are, the government has absolutely no right to breach this right to privacy. I think the struggle is, and we live in a time, not necessarily actually in Western societies of huge violence, but of huge amounts of fear. Mm. And you have to be prepared to compromise that potentially to almost to release the level people's level of fear. And I think that's what you're offsetting it against. Personally, I think there is also a sort of technical issue there that if companies build backdoors into computers and to devices, what that could be used for. I perhaps am slightly more skeptical than Sir John about the role of government, but I think there has to be a balance found somewhere.
Yeah, and backdoors. It's interesting this argument of backdoors because the technology companies always come back with this riposte. Oh, well, we can't create a backdoor because that will help the bad guys as well as it helping others. I don't think anybody's talking about backdoors. It's the front door they're talking about. It's about the ability for technology companies to be able to monitor what is happening on their systems. And if there is a legal warrant to provide some of that information to a law enforcement agency, that they have the capacity to do that.
So what you're saying is that technology companies, you feel, have an obligation to monitor what's going on their system?
The obligation, technology companies can only thrive if the society is based on law and order, if they have access to the courts for due duress, if the law is broken, due redress rather, that the society in which they're operating in is one which is institutionally ordered, and in the same way that ever since the telephone was created, telecoms companies have been able to cooperate with law enforcement agencies in order to provide in the exceptional cases when someone's activity on the telephone threatened security or law and order or child protection or whatever, that they could be monitored. I don't see it's any different now just because the means of communication is rather more complicated than the telephone.
Okay. But there's two points you seem to be making. One is a technology company has the obligation to cooperate with law enforcement.
Yep.
Two, the technology company has the obligation to monitor what's going on in its network.
Well,
should they file suspicious transaction reports like a bank does?
Yeah.
I walk into HSBC with $100,000 in a brown envelope and hand it over the counter, and they say, "Where did you get this money, Mr. Wootliff?" I say, "I'm not telling you."
Yeah.
They probably file a report somewhere, and it gradually works its way up, and I get a knock on the door at some point.
Yeah. Well, and Facebook try and do this. If someone says on Facebook, "I'm going to kill that bastard," well, then that leads to a suspicious report following that. Of course, a lot of terrorist activity on the internet or on these communication systems is much more subtle than that.
Absolutely.
And much harder to detect. Now, that doesn't mean that Facebook and these other companies should have great hordes of people monitoring this, but you can monitor a lot of this technically.
Yeah.
I think there is a mutual obligation between governments who are there to protect public goods and private companies who are making most of the investment in the technology to have some degree of cooperation between them, the two of them.
At this point, maybe we move to the audience. It's the success of a panel is determined by how much back and forth happens. That was a great start. It's a topic that cannot be decided. I think it's going to go into the courts and everybody will have their opinion, but I guess both sides have a very valid point to varying degrees, and which is why the debate is there. Let's go to the audience. We have one question here.
Thank you so far. Maybe this is a bit lowbrow, but I'm interested, I don't know whether each of you have kids, but whether there's two or three things you think we can do, right, in the cyber security sense to protect our kids. Just simple things.
I think your kids are probably wiser than you are. I don't worry about my daughter growing up in a world of in a connected world. I actually think she'll be, I mean, how do we talk to our kids? No client's ever asked me this question, so, but how do we talk to our kids about security? Well, if you see a stranger, and he asks you to do something that you're not comfortable with, don't do it. I think the same can apply in the online world. If you see something where you're not familiar, you're not comfortable with, back away. Don't be afraid to ask an adult, your parents, for help. Those sorts of things. I think one should, take a sort of common sense attitude towards it. And you monitor your children's activity to some extent in real life. Well, to some extent, you also have a right, a duty to monitor them in the virtual world. Remember, one of the things about kids, and my daughter's quite young, so she's not quite at the sort of operating in the virtual world yet, but I see this among my nieces, is that they don't discriminate really to the same extent between their virtual, their Facebook lives, their Snapchat lives, and their physical lives. You'll see a bunch of sort of 14-year-olds and all be sat in the same room and all be conversing with each other and texting each other. So it's within that space, common sense applies generally.
And you drew that parallel with banking earlier. And I think one of the big things in banking in the last 15 years has been know your customer.
Mm-hmm.
I think on the internet, it's about know who you're talking to, know the person at the other end. One of the biggest risks of the internet is anonymity. I think, if you ever write an article in a newspaper or something, the worst thing to do is to click on the comments section afterwards, because you get a great stream of anonymous abuse. There's never any a constructive comment in those abuses. It's all just some damnation and something extremely rude. That's because people aren't accountable for what they say on those comments, and usually it's completely anonymous. And I think the biggest risk for a younger generation is you get drawn from a circle of known friends who you've got a relationship in the real world with and you want to carry it on in the virtual world, to a relationship where it's only in the virtual world and you've got no certainty who's on the other end of that. So I haven't coined a bumper sticker for it, but you need an equivalent of know your customer for your kids' activity on the internet.
Could you comment a little bit on the geopolitical side of things? You talked about state actors, but obviously they're doing that for geopolitical reasons. And this seems like the sort of area where you've had conflict in the past, where things like treaties have emerged that have defined the way in which state actors relate to each other. Is this something that could emerge in the future, given that much of the diplomatic activity seems to actually be being used by the more manipulative powers that you referred to try and expand their scope rather than what treaties normally do, which is to try and bind people?
Well, I think this is an area which is very underdeveloped. The scope of the dialogue and the depth of the dialogue between governments about cyber issues. I was involved in it to some extent in my last job. I visited Beijing a number of times. I had conversations with the Chinese about this. They weren't comfortable conversations, but nonetheless, they were conversations that needed to be had. I found the United States actually rather reluctant to get engaged in these areas. They had a number of reasons, some of them technically driven. But it was very interesting when an actor in China, question mark who it might have been, but an actor in China broke into the Office of Personnel Management in Washington just a couple of months before President Xi Jinping's visit to the US, where finally the Americans blew a fuse because someone had stolen the information of the 1.8 million people cleared to have classified information. And as a former intelligence chief, I can tell you that's absolute gold dust. If you've got all the people who have got access to classified information and you can link them all together and you know what's in their security files, well, that's exactly what an intelligence agency needs. So that did prompt the first ever serious high-level conversation between the Americans and the Chinese. And it led to a bit of a standoff, but nonetheless a recognition that there was a serious step here that had gone too far and that the Chinese needed, whoever was responsible in China, needed to back off. But I think the striking feature I find of all my conversations on this issue is that every government feels much more vulnerable than they feel there's an opportunity here. So if you talk to a country like China, they're concerned about how they are vulnerable to threats to undermine their system, whether you like their system or not, but whether the threats to undermine their system, whether from foreign state actors like the United States or Britain or Japan or whoever it might be, or from their own domestic opposition. So I think there is a common base of concern that we all have vulnerabilities. In the West, our biggest concern is our critical national infrastructure. If someone brings down the energy system or the power system or the banking system, then you could bring down the entire sort of structure of our society. So protecting our critical national infrastructure is absolutely fundamental for us. For other countries, there might be other things which are absolutely fundamental. But I think there is a basis of common ground that could be built that would provide some rules of the road for agreement between countries as to what is what should be excluded, what an attack constitutes, what a response should look like, and above all, what is a red line which would if crossed, provoke a much wider response. Now, you can't do that in the UN system. I know I'm a great fan of the UN system. I was ambassador at the UN, but I know its weaknesses only too well. It can only be done amongst a small number of the most cyber-capable countries, which provides a set of standards that then others adhere to, a bit like the Non-Proliferation Treaty did on nuclear weapons. But we are so far away from that because the level of the dialogue is so immature, and every country seems to be concerned about being drawn into it. Now, what I'm afraid of is that we've never had a cyber equivalent of 9/11. And I tell you, if we did have a major incident that brought down a banking system or brought down somebody's power structure or brought down the sort of medical system of a country, which is entirely possible, then we'd be having the cyber equivalent of a 9/11, and that would jump us all into action. But I do not want to wait for that moment before governments start doing the things which I think are necessary. And I do think it's possible to have that dialogue and to build that sort of approach. In nuclear terms, in the cyber world, in nuclear terms, we're in the 1950s, where we've got the power, we've got the capability, but we've got no real means of controlling that power in an intergovernmental or on a legal basis. And there's a lot of work to be done.
I think the nuclear analogy is a very good one. One of the concerns about cyber is, whereas the development of nuclear weapons, the proliferation, was pretty slow. Mm. And even now, it hasn't proliferated.
It's very expensive.
It's very expensive. You need a huge investment in technology and people. The problem is that the proliferation of cyber weaponry is actually, as I said, 45 countries essentially publicly identified as having cyber weaponry, probably a load more beyond that. And the capability is, well, we've already seen attacks. We've already seen 9/11 style attacks in what was the Ukraine power grid was taken down the other week.
Yep, it's true.
I mean, and this is...
Ukraine power grid is rather different from the New York power grid.
But, well, not if you're living in Kiev.
Well, that's true. Not many journalists do.
Yeah. So, but it's, you know, I think we're at that point already where that capability exists. Yeah. So that is my concern. I think, as you say, I think China and US have blinked a little bit now and said, actually, maybe this has gone too far. Mm. China, I think what they will do is they will bring their various intelligence actors, get them lined up a little bit more effectively now, so.
I couldn't possibly comment.
Yeah. We have time for a couple more questions. The one at the back.
So we've seen a lot of publicity about end-to-end encryption over the last couple of days with WhatsApp and so on. So how much is that both a good thing for people that want to protect good things, but also a very difficult thing, again, in the security space? But then schizophrenically, the quantum computers, if they actually get going, will mean encryption's impossible, right? So all governments are working on quantum computers. Probably you've already done it, you know, knowing you lot. But so how are we, have we got like this short-term sort of window where end-to-end encryption might be very, you know, very powerful, but then again just gets cracked by the quantum computers?
Yeah, well, I think I answered it earlier about this question between privacy and security. I think encryption is really important for society. I think the quality of encryption is important. I think if terrorist groups or organized criminals are able to break encryption, well, that's a danger to our society. So the keys to encryption need to be held in responsible hands and to be able to be used in a responsible and in a legal way. I think you're always going to get this sort of going up so that at one stage the technology outpasses the counter technology, and then the counter technology will outmuscle the technology. If you understand what I'm saying on these things, but I go back to my original point: completely closed, impenetrable space benefits the enemies of society more than it benefits society itself.
Coming back to your point about if no information is completely secure, I think that would make an interesting geopolitical moment. I think we see this to some extent at the moment. One of the issues that governments are struggling with is they're almost challenged by the end of secrecy. I mean, banking is struggling with this. It will be a moment to behold when governments cannot keep their secrets.
So. Given we're at a investment conference, just wondering, which are the companies that stand out in your mind as the ones that are leading the charge? I'm not asking for a recommendation. But, you know, are we beyond, you know, once upon a time when you first got your computer, you downloaded Norton antivirus and, you know, Symantec was the company that everyone wanted to own. But, you know, I think we're well and truly beyond worrying about a virus on a computer, talking about cyber threats. Which are the companies leading the charge to make the world safer on the cyberspace?
I think I'm not going to give recommendations because I think the challenge about cybersecurity actually is there's not one solution to it. And I think your question sort of rests upon, is there one solution to this multifaceted problem? As I say, you know, when your biggest issue is the insider threat, Sir John has rightly pointed out, well, actually, that's a governance issue. And you're there about finding the right balance between how much information you give to your employees and how much you deny them. So I'm loath to say, actually, there's a silver bullet to solve it. And I think any technology companies, it's in their DNA almost to say, we have this technology which will change everything. But I don't think there really is a technology. And I would be very wary if I was a buyer of this technology to have somebody say to me, this is going to solve all your problems. Because it's firstly, there is always a new technology. And secondly, the challenge with technology is the implementation of it, how you use it within your organization. Coming back to sort of the 9/11 moment, looking back, there was information out there. The failure was not one of technology. It wasn't having the information. The failure was, unfortunately, of intelligence analysis, that people couldn't spot what was, with 2020 hindsight, in front of them. So,
are any of these companies offering the cyber attacks with help desks and all those? Are any of those listed companies?
No, but I, you know, you could see a business opportunity for buying a sort of dark web, you know, stock exchange for buying and selling equity stakes. I mean, people will sell their business. If you look at the example of Silk Road, Silk Road was the dark web drug dealing network, essentially, run by a guy who named himself Dread Pirate Roberts. And people offered to buy his business. And that's not necessarily a cyber crime in the nature that we're discussing it now, but you know, people will buy and sell these businesses.
Is there a question somewhere here?
Given that the biggest threat is from an insider, and given the capabilities of the hackers, how effective is corporate spending combating this? And how much of that is just theater so they can tell their board, we did everything we could?
I don't know the answer about the balance of corporate spending. I do think, as I said earlier, that the least appreciated part of the cyber threat is the insider threat. Now, in an intelligence agency, we've always been very mindful of the insider threat because there's always been attempts by foreign intelligence agencies to recruit members of intelligence agencies. So the systems of vetting, of clearing, of constantly being aware of the behavior of your staff, there's a much more intrusive system into the internet activities of members of intelligence agencies than would be of any other normal citizen. Now, companies can't do that. But having a much greater awareness of the vulnerabilities of individuals, the pressures they may be going through, pressures they may be coming under, that an organization under stress is particularly vulnerable, I think bringing these ideas into the corporate world is going to be very, very important. It's not just about technology spending. It's about configuring your HR departments to understand that the individuals don't only need to have the right skills, they need to offset against the wrong vulnerabilities, not just at the recruitment phase, but as people go through life, because you know, companies go through phases and individuals go through phases of different vulnerability as they go forward. I think the witting insider threat is badly understood. I think the unwitting insider problem is one of education from top to bottom of the organization. Again, very few corporates really do this in a systematic way. There's a whole lot further they can go.
Yeah, I mean, I completely agree.
We are running out of time. I want to interject one question because that's what probably people want to answer, and that's for Ben. If we walk into company meetings, what questions as investors or analysts we should ask to gauge how prepared the companies are?
I think the biggest, when we look at a company and to help them sort of understand their cyber maturity, the first question we ask is around governance. Who is responsible for cybersecurity within your organization? Uh-huh. And show me how that works and builds into your broader risk thing. And if they come back to you and say, it's a technology problem, we've got a technology guy dealing with it, then I'd start worrying slightly. So.
Thank you very much. We have run out of time. Thank you very much. That was
Thank you.
Thank you. Very insightful session. Thank you. Thanks, John.